मेरा रंग रूप बिगड़ गया, मेरा यार मुझसे बिछड़ गया। जो चमन खिजा से फसले बार हूँ।
Nearly 100 years of British rule had utterly impoverished the Indian people, culturally, politically, and economically, when they rose up in revolt in 1857. On the 10th of May, Indian soldiers revolted in Meerut and marched to Delhi. The next day, Bahadur Shah Zafar was declared Emperor of Hindustan. Bahadur Shah asked the Hindus and Muslims to join hands in their fight for freedom, the best of all the gifts of God. Under the command of General Bakht Khan, the valiant revolutionaries defended Delhi for 4 months. Similar deeds of unity and valor were witnessed on several battlefields. At Kanpur, Nana Sahib of Bithur led the revolt with his most trusted emissary, Azimullah Khan. The revolutionary sepoys of Awadh rallied round Begum Hazrat Mahal, wife of the deposed King Bajid Ali Shah. They besieged the British residency in Lucknow for 8 long months. They defeated several British attempts before they were overcome by superior firepower. In Jhansi, the young Rani Lakshmibai raised the banner of revolt. Khalq Khuda ka, Mulk Badshah ka, aur Hukum Rani Lakshmibai ka. General Ghaus Khan, commander of the Rani's artillery, was killed in action.
जिसे देखा हाकिम वक्त ने कहा ये भी काबिलेदार है, गई यक बयक जो हवा पलट।
Bahadur Shah Zafar was arrested and exiled to Burma.
Kitna hai badnaseeb Zafar, dafn ke liye do gaz zameen bhi
to his last breath, he longed to return to his beloved country. The British launched their policy of divide and rule. Lord Roberts said, "The British should work with their life's best blood to show these rascally Muslims that with God's help, Englishmen will still be masters of India." British exploitation devastated the Indian economy. The common people suffered the most, especially artisans and peasants. Since most Muslims refused to accept Western education, their economic plight was aggravated. In this atmosphere, in 1875, Sir Syed Ahmad Khan founded the Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College. He said, "I regard both Hindus and Muslims as my two eyes." The growing spirit of nationalism in the country led to the birth of the Indian National Congress in 1885 at Bombay. W.C. Banerjee was the first president. The second session in Calcutta had Dadabhai Naoroji as president. Badruddin Thayabji, an eminent barrister from Bombay, presided over the third Congress in Madras. He said, "I have ever denounced all communal and sectarian prejudices." In 1896, the president of the Calcutta Congress, Rahmatullah Sayani, blamed British economic policy, which had deliberately impoverished the country. In 1905, Lord Curzon announced the partition of Bengal on communal lines. This was vehemently opposed by both Hindus and Muslims. Rabindranath Tagore wrote, "This day should be observed as a day signifying the unbreakable bonds of brotherhood between the people of East Bengal and the people of West Bengal, between Christians, Muslims, Hindus born of this earth." Maulana Abul Kalam Azad started the Al Hilal, an influential newspaper in Calcutta, exhorting Muslims to join the freedom struggle. Al Hilal was banned. He then started Al Balagh with the same message. This too was banned, and Maulana was externed to Ranchi. 1913, Nawab Sayyid Muhammad presided over the Congress session and said, "The India of today is not the India of Hindus and Muslims, but the India in which all have a share." 1914, the First World War. Over 100,000 Indian soldiers fought on different battlefronts. When the Home Rule movement was started by Annie Besant and Bal Gangadhar Tilak, eminent leaders such as Hasrat Mohani, Muhammad Ali, Shaukat Ali, Jawaharlal Nehru and others became members. Some revolutionaries left India and established the Provisional Government of India in exile at Kabul, with Raja Mahendra Pratap as president and Barkatullah Khan as prime minister. The annual sessions of the Congress and the Muslim League were held at the same venue, Lucknow. Both the parties passed the same resolution. The British should declare that self-government be granted to India at an early date. When Gandhiji launched the Champaran Satyagraha against the exploitation of indigo plantation workers, his most ardent supporter was Mazhar-ul Haq, a staunch nationalist and president of the Home Rule movement in Bihar. In 1919, there was an upsurge of Hindu-Muslim unity. Swami Shraddhananda and other leaders addressed a congregation at the Jama Masjid in Delhi. Alarmed at such communal unity, the British arrested two respected leaders of Amritsar, Dr. Saifuddin Kichlu and Satyapal. On the 13th of April, the day of Baisakhi, people of all communities held a meeting at Jallianwala Bagh to condemn the British action. General Dyer opened fire on a peaceful assembly. 379 persons were killed and 1,200 wounded. This barbaric act shocked the entire nation. During this time, the people of India were concerned about the fate of the Sultan of Turkey, the Khalifa. In November 1919, Gandhiji was invited to attend the Khilafat conference in Delhi. On his advice, the conference agreed to launch a non-cooperation movement in support of Khilafat. Tens of thousands of Hindus, Muslims, and people belonging to every community in India joined mammoth processions. The Ali brothers traveled with Gandhiji throughout India to preach Hindu-Muslim unity and seek support for the movement. A mass movement was launched for boycott of foreign goods, British courts and educational institutions. In UP, Purushottam Das Tandon, Jawaharlal Nehru, and Rafi Ahmed Kidwai led the peasant movement. Under the leadership of Dr. Zakir Hussain, 300 students left Aligarh University and founded the Jamia Millia, which was run on Gandhian principles of self-help. The Congress session in Kakinada in 1923 was presided over by Maulana Muhammad Ali. He asked the people to maintain peace, harmony, and goodwill among all communities. Revolutionaries from different parts of the country regrouped to form the Hindustan Republican Army and the Communist Party. In Bengal, Qazi Nazrul Islam and Muzaffar Ahmad were the leading communists. In the Kakori train hold-up case, Ram Prasad Bismil, Manmath Nath Gupta, Rajendranath Lahiri, Ashfaqullah Khan, Roshan Singh and others were arrested. Ashfaqullah, Bismil and Roshan Singh were sentenced to death. From his prison cell, Ashfaqullah sent a message to his countrymen. Brothers, your disunity can never prove beneficial to either one of you. You can unite and remove the collar of slavery from around your necks. The 1927 Congress session at Madras was presided over by Maqbool Ahmad Ansari. A resolution was passed asking the people to boycott the Simon Commission, which was visiting India to look into the working of representative institutions but had no Indian member on it. When the Simon Commission arrived in February of 1928, it was met everywhere with strikes, protests and demonstrations. In 1929, Jawaharlal Nehru presided over the Congress session at Lahore. Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan attended the Congress with a large contingent of Khudai Khidmatgars. When Gandhiji's appeal for removal of the tax on salt was ignored, he started on his long march to Dandi. On the 6th of April, Gandhiji was arrested and the leadership passed on to Abbas Tayyabji and on his arrest to Sarojini Naidu. Khan Abdul Ghaffar Khan led the civil disobedience movement in Peshawar, capital of the Northwest Frontier Province. The Khudai Khidmatgars remained absolutely peaceful. Garhwali soldiers were called in. They refused to obey the order to open fire and faced court-martial. In 1931, Gandhiji attended the second roundtable conference in London to discuss the future of India. The British deliberately brought up the communal question and the talks were deadlocked. Gandhiji returned home empty-handed. The non-cooperation movement was resumed and Gandhiji was arrested. Tens of thousands remained non-violent in spite of British batons and bullets. When elections to the provincial assemblies were held in 1937, Maulana Azad emerged as the foremost spokesman of secular nationalism. Azad and Kidwai were to remain close colleagues of Jawaharlal to the end of their lives. In 1939, when World War II began, India had been declared a belligerent without consulting her people. In protest, the Congress ministries resigned. Maulana Azad was declared Congress president. He said, "I am proud of being an Indian. I am a part of the indivisible unity that is Indian nationality. I am an essential element which has gone to build India. I can never surrender this claim." The Congress said that India could support the war effort only as a free nation, but the Muslim League demanded partition. When the Japanese forces were approaching the borders of India, Sir Stafford Cripps arrived in March 1942 to seek the cooperation of Indian leaders. His promise of freedom in the distant future was not acceptable to the Congress. The League, however, once again insisted on a decision on partition. On the 8th of August 1942, the Congress met in Bombay under the presidentship of Maulana Azad. He asked the British to withdraw and said, "Power when it comes will belong to all the people of India." The Quit India Resolution was unanimously passed. The entire leadership was imprisoned on the 9th of August. But the people kept on with the struggle. Meanwhile, Subhash Chandra Bose escaped from house arrest in Calcutta and reached Germany. Accompanied by his secretary, Abid Hasan, he reached Singapore. Abid Hasan was the man who coined the slogan, Jai Hind. Subhash Chandra Bose took over command of the Indian National Army, comprising of Indian troops who were prisoners of war, local volunteers and women. The Provisional Government of Azad Hind, formed on the 21st of October 1943, had S.A. Iyer, Shahnawaz Khan, Muhammad Zaman Kiani, N. Raghavan, Ehsan Qadir and Dr. Lakshmi Swaminathan amongst the ministers. The INA fought up to the borders of India and planted the first flag of free India in Manipur. When they surrendered at the end of the war, three INA officers, Sehgal, Dhillon and Shahnawaz Khan, were put on trial by the British government. Nehru, Sapru, Katju, Bhullabhai Desai, Asif Ali and others defended them. The British were compelled to release them unconditionally. A cabinet mission arrived from London to hold negotiations for the transfer of power. Azad, Nehru, Abdul Ghaffar Khan, Patel, Gandhi, and in fact the entire leadership insisted on freedom for an undivided India. The Muslim League insisted on partition. In August of 1946, when the interim government under Nehru was formed, with Asif Ali and Ali Zahir as Congress ministers, the Muslim League objected to their inclusion. In October, the League finally joined the interim government, but frictions developed between ministers and frequently the administration came to a standstill. In March of 1947, Mountbatten became the Viceroy of India. The British government announced the transfer of power to India as soon as possible, with or without partition. Lord Mountbatten insisted that only acceptance of partition could ensure early independence. Maulana Azad said, "I pointed out that if we accepted partition, we would create a permanent problem for India." It was with great sorrow that the Congress accepted the fact that partition was inevitable. Ghaffar Khan wept and accused the Congress of an act of treachery. A movement nurtured till the end by the unity and sacrifice of the people of India ended in partition and sorrow for many millions. After independence, Kashmir was invaded by Pakistan. In this hour of crisis, Sheikh Abdullah led the people of Kashmir in their fight against the raiders. Kashmir decided to accede to India. Sheikh Abdullah said, "Today the raiders from Pakistan are a few miles from Srinagar. They're raising the slogan of Islam. It is open to you to be with them or to be with me. If you opt to be with me, you must know that you have to live for all time on the principle that Hindus, Muslims and Sikhs are brothers." A majority of Muslims decided to stay in India, for India was their home, their heritage, and their future was bound with that of their fellow countrymen. This was re-emphasized by Dr. Zakir Hussain when he was elected President of India.
"I pledge myself to the service of the totality of my country's culture. I pledge myself to work for its strength and progress and for the welfare of its people, without distinction of caste, color, or creed. The whole of Bharat is my home, and the people are my family."